Good morning, this is Prior Smith speaking. Here are the news headlines for vacationing Canadians throughout Florida. The ongoing feud between the Ford brothers in Toronto, Ontario's Premier Kathleen Wynne. Big Oil hits back at Neil Young. And wealthy Canadians say they need at least $2 million in the bank before they feel comfortable retiring. All of those stories and more, please join me for Canada Calling. For 60 years, a daily update of Canadian news.
Canada Calling this afternoon at noon here on the Tan Talk Radio Network.
WTAN Clearwater, Tampa Bay. WDCF Dade City, Tampa Bay. WZHR Zephyr Hills, Tampa Bay. Listen.
Welcome to Outbreak News This Week with your host, microbiologist and co-founder of theglobaldispatch.com, Robert Harriman.
Good morning, Tampa Bay, and those listening online from Boise to Berlin. This is your source for all the news about worms and germs. This is Outbreak News This Week, and I am your host, Robert Harriman. It's a Saturday morning, so joining me every Saturday morning running the controls is Billy. Good morning, Billy. How you doing, sir?
We are germ-free.
And speaking of Billy, I had the opportunity last night to see Billy Joel here at the Tampa Bay Times. Fantastic show. I want to thank Nate for the tickets, and we got to see it from the suite. So I was eating bratwurst and watching Billy Joel. Fantastic time. His voice has really held up over time. And it's a really good show, and he's got a fantastic New York wit to him. Let's go ahead and get to today's topic, which is influenza. So I'll switch from talking about one talented New Yorker to talking to another talented New Yorker. On the phone, I have Columbia University microbiology and immunology professor, Dr. Vincent Racaniello. Good morning, Vincent. How are you doing today, sir?
Hey, good morning, Robert. And I should tell you that I once sat next to Billy Joel at a sushi bar in New York City.
Fantastic. Did you get to talk to him?
I didn't, but he was speaking Japanese with the chef.
He's just, what a performer. He's just so talented. And I know he's gone through some troubles and stuff, but he sounded fantastic last night. Let's get to the business at hand. The news has been inundated with influenza. Of all sorts.
Time of year, right?
No, yeah, of all sorts, though. And I guess to the regular media consumer, this alphanumeric soup of influenza, it may be a little confusing. We hear of H1N1, H7N9, H5N1, and so on and so forth. So let's go ahead and I want to pick your brain, and let's start out by explaining, what is the H, what is the N? And what do these subscript numbers mean?
Okay, so we start with the virus, the influenza virus, which is a tiny particle that you can't see. It is made up of a membrane. Inside that is the genetic information of the virus, and these are spherical viruses. And on the surface of the membrane, there are a couple of different proteins, viral proteins, that are required for the virus to infect cells. And two of the major ones are called the hemagglutinin, or HA, and the neuraminidase, or NA. And these can be abbreviated H and N. So when we talk about H1N1 and H3N2 viruses, we're talking about the precise kinds of HA and NA on the virus particle. That's how we classify influenza A viruses.
Okay, and what is the function of the H and what is the function of the N? Is there a particular...
Sure. So the HA, or the H, is essential for the virus to attach to a cell. Now, all viruses to reproduce need to get inside of a cell. They can't do it any other way. And they usually start by attaching to the surface of a cell to a receptor. So the HA of influenza virus is the key protein for attaching to receptors on the host cell. And the NA is actually an enzyme that cleaves the receptors off of cells. And we think this is important when new viruses are made from cells, that this enzyme cleaves the receptor off so that the viruses can spread away from the cells. So two key surface proteins. And if you make antibodies against either one of these when you're infected with the virus, these can effectively block virus infection.
Perfect. Now, the big things in the news in the past couple of weeks, of course, has been H1N1. It's not that it has ever gone away, but it has resurfaced in a major way this year. H7N9 in China, which is, I can't even look at the reports on a day-to-day basis without seeing, you know, 4 to 6 new cases.
Right.
But the big story last week was the young lady that traveled to Beijing, and she contracted H5N1, a very pathogenic type of influenza, and came back home and died in Alberta, Canada. Now, both the CDC and Public Health Canada immediately came out with announcements, and both of them, you know, basically weren't very concerned about her infection spreading to other people on the plane, in the hospital, et cetera, saying there's no evidence of sustained human-to-human transmission. Now, at the same time, the H1N1, which was the swine flu of the 2009-2010 pandemic, spreads like wildfire, person to person. Why are people, scientists, virologists, public health officials, not very concerned about the spread of H5N1 from person to person? Because we have a lethality rate of about 60% with this virus. What is that virus lacking that keeps it from spreading from person to person?
Well, Robert, that is the million-dollar question for influenza. And if someone could figure it out, we might be able to really lick this infection. So the human viruses, the H1N1s, the H3N2s, these are all well-adapted human strains that transmit very well among people, like wildfire. The H5N1, we know from observing, there have been just over 600 cases since we've been monitoring them, to just don't spread well among people. There's no sustained transmission from person to person to person to person, which you would need to have an epidemic. Why this is so, we really don't understand. As far as we know, so far, only H1, H2, and H3 influenza viruses can transmit really well among humans. The H5N1s don't transmit well. The H7N9s, which are currently circulating in China, don't spread well either. And why this is the case, a lot of people are trying to figure out. And you remember the very controversial experiments of Fouché and Kawaoka last year.
Yes, I do.
Where they adapted H5N1 to transmit by aerosol in ferrets. Well, they were trying to get at this question. And, of course, you can't do these experiments in people. So you need to use an animal model, and they did it in ferrets. And they found that certain mutations in the H or the HA of these viruses will allow them to transmit among ferrets. So maybe that's what's needed in the H5N1 strains, but it hasn't happened yet. So right now we're kind of lucky in that the people who get infected, are unfortunately many of them die, but the viruses don't transmit to others.
Right. And I can recall 3 or 4 years ago, I went to a bioterrorism symposium at the Florida Department of Health, and one of the virologists were speaking on H5N1 at the time, and essentially she was saying that is the biggest fear right now. This is, you know, several years ago.
Right.
That this thing can mutate and become like H1N1, but it would kill way more people.
Well, that's a great question, whether it will happen. You know, these H5N1s have been circulating for many years now, and such transmissible viruses have not emerged in people. Who knows whether it will happen at some point? And who knows whether, if that happened, if they acquired human transmissibility, if they would retain this high virulence, this high case fatality rate ratio. I'm going to be talking to Yoshikawa Oka in a couple of weeks on my podcast, and we'll get his thoughts on this as well.
Oh, that'd be great. Let me go ahead and open up the phone lines. If you've got a question for Dr. Racaniello concerning anything influenza, if you're in the Tampa Bay area, 727-441-3000. Or if you're outside the Tampa Bay area, toll-free 1-866-826-1340. Getting back to the H5N1 case, the Canadian case presented with neurological symptoms. Not unheard of, but not the most common symptom of that strain. So H5N1 is very devastating, very pathogenic. What is typically seen in a patient that has this virus?
So that your typical H5N1 infection, of course, involves a respiratory illness, although in this case, the young lady didn't have respiratory symptoms, you know, no coughing or sneezing, but typically respiratory symptoms preceding to pneumonia, typically respiratory failure. You can't breathe, so you have to put on support. Multiple organ failure sometimes as the virus is replicating in many places. And in half of the known cases, you can have death. So this individual had malaise, chest pain, fever, difficulty breathing. She didn't have respiratory symptoms, but an X-ray did indicate pneumonia, and that's why they initially treated her with antibiotics instead of realizing that it was an influenza infection.
So do you believe that the CDC and Public Health Canada handled this properly as far as PR?
Absolutely. I think we got a lot of good information right up front. There was no hiding anything. It was made very clear that the woman was not treated for influenza infection initially, which would have been nice to do, but you know, no one was suspecting this. This is the first case of an exported H5N1 infection to North America. Either North America or South America. So no one was thinking about it. Now I think people will be more vigilant.
Sure. Let's switch gears a little bit to the seasonal flu. And like I said earlier, H1N1 never really went away. However, it is back, and this year it is the predominant strain once again. Over the past 2 to 3 years, H3N2 was the predominant strain, and that seasonal flu, its pathology was most harsh on elderly people, 65 and older. That's where we saw the fatalities. However, we're seeing lots of reports of people my age and younger, young adults to middle age, dying from H1N1 this year. What explains the difference in susceptible populations with these different strains? Do we have an answer for that?
I'm sorry to say, Robert, that we don't.
Don't.
This is the way virology often goes. It has a lot to do with the immunity of the population, and from season to season, how many people have antibodies to a particular flu strain. But flu viruses themselves differ in their virulence. So, you know, the H3 viruses are more virulent than H1 viruses in people in general. And again, we can't understand that very well because we can't study this in people. We can't modify viruses and put them in people.
Right.
We can do that in animals like ferrets, but those are animals. They're not people, so they don't always give you the same answer that you might find in people.
So like in 2009, 2010, when H1N1 reared its ugly head, did it spread the way it did and cause the pathology that it did because of a naive population?
Yeah, in part. So, you know, in 2009, we had already had H1N1 viruses circulating, interestingly, but this was a different enough one that there were sufficient numbers of people who didn't have immune protection against it that the virus could spread like crazy globally. Fortunately, it wasn't as virulent as it could have been. As I said, it's milder than H3 in general. So, again, it's population immunity. Different groups have different susceptibilities, as you said, young versus old, And we really don't understand that, and these are very difficult things to figure out.
Yeah, and I guess one question some people have are, you know, why do we see one strain predominant 1 year and another one the next year?
Yeah.
I guess this is more of an epidemiology type question. How does this happen? Why is H1N1 big this year?
So this is a really interesting story. I used to work on influenza in the late 70s, early 80s with Peter Blasey, who's a well-known flu researcher in New York City. And at that time, there used to be only one influenza A strain circulating globally in people. So when I was working on it, it was H3N2, which emerged in 1968. And before 68, it was H2N2, which emerged in 1957. All of a sudden, in 1977, an H1N1 strain was released. We don't really understand how that happened, but that was a strain that had been circulating in the 50s. And from that year to the present, we've had more than one influenza A virus circulating. So right now, we've had H3N2s and H1N1s of different types circulating since 1977. And that's really strange to me because that has never happened before. Then the question is, what causes one to predominate over another from year to year, as you said? One of the theories, which is Peter Pelosi's theories, is that, first of all, the H's, you know, there are 18 different H's of influenza virus, and they can be put into two different groups. And Peter's theory is that only viruses with different HA groups can coexist. So in 2009, the H1N1 came in. It induced in people who were previously exposed to H1N1 antibodies against the stalk of the virus. All right, the stalk of the hemagglutinin protein is a very conserved region to which it's very rare to make antibodies. But if you can make antibodies to this stalk, you can get rid of the virus. So in 2009, when that H1N1 came in, antibodies were generated against the stalk in people who had already seen an H1N1, and that extincted the previous H1N1 viruses. Now, if an H2 appeared right now, today, we don't have any H2 viruses circulating, it would probably extinguish the currently circulating H1N1 strains because it would induce antibodies against the stalk of these viruses, which is conserved between H2 and N1, and it would extinguish those, but not the H3 strains. So maybe the H2 and the H3 would co-circulate. So that's one idea for why they switch from year to year. And, of course, it also has to do with population immunity, how many people have been infected 1 year versus the next.
All right, Vincent, I got to take a quick 90-second break. I want you to hold on, and we'll come back for a few more questions, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Okay, Bill, go ahead.
Hi, this is Robert with Outbreak News This Week. When your words mean business, you want to get it right. If your organization produces manuals, reports, grant applications, or newsletters, or if you're a student or academic preparing a thesis or manuscript, consider the professional editorial services of XL Editing. Visit xlediting.com to see their full line of services and affordable rates. That's xcellediting.com. Are you a medical technologist, microbiologist, a student, or someone who just loves parasitology? Then you need to check out the website, Parasites in Black and White. We currently have three designs, clean, computerized images of Giardia, T. cruzi, and the blood flukes, for t-shirts, coffee mugs, and a whole bunch of other gifts and merchandise. To check out what's available, Google Parasites in Black and White. That's Parasites in Black and White.
Well, welcome back to the show. I am joined by Dr. Vincent Racaniello, microbiology and immunology professor from Columbia University, and we're talking influenza. Vincent, let's go into the flu shot real quick, because I think of a lot of lay people do not understand how this works. Each year, there's a federal body of different authorities that decide what strains to cover in each season flu shot. How exactly does this work?
Okay, so what happens is this whole thing is coordinated by the World Health Organization. They have laboratories, thousands of labs throughout the world, that every year sample from people who have influenza, and they isolate viruses and look at what type of HA and NA they have. So this goes on throughout the year in the northern and southern hemispheres, and they collect information on what strains are circulating. Then they meet twice a year. Various federal health authorities of different countries meet twice a year to decide the vaccine for the northern hemisphere and the vaccine for the southern hemisphere, because the seasons, of course, are reversed.
Right.
So in February, the meetings take place for the northern hemisphere. That would be in the fall, and in September for the southern hemisphere's vaccine. So let's take the northern hemisphere. In February, they say, okay, we have to change the flu vaccine because the strains are changing. They would release that information, and then the vaccine manufacturers take it. They begin making vaccine, which takes about 6 months, and then by the fall, the vaccine is ready to go.
Okay. Now, does this have anything to do with what's circulating in China and Asia at the time?
Yeah, so they look at viruses circulating globally. They try and see what is predominating in a certain region and whether there have been movements of certain strains from one region to another. It's a really big database of information that they try and coordinate. And they have committees made up of a lot of epidemiologists and influenza virologists that try and reduce this data to a recommendation.
Right. And it's not an exact science by no means.
Absolutely not.
Yeah. Yeah, it's amazing that they do as well as they do.
Well, some years they do well, and other years they miss.
Exactly. Let's switch gears to the H7N9. Like I said earlier, just about every day I'm seeing press releases out of the Hong Kong CHP, talking about 4, 5, 6 new cases on a daily basis. And so they're surging in China. This virus was first found in humans just about a year ago, mm-hmm. In China. And we went through a pretty much of a lull during the summer months into the fall, but it's back. What explains the resurgence of this virus at this point?
Well, I would guess that the main factor is that we are now in the flu season in China. It's getting cool. It's cooler there, especially mm-hmm. in the north, but in other parts it's also cooler. And we know that in temperate climates, that is a climate with a summer and a winter, influenza is seasonal and largely occurs in the winter months, which is not to say it doesn't happen all year round. There probably are cases continuously, but very much lower. So I think that's probably a big part of it. I also think right now is a big travel period in China, people moving around, and that's another way to move infections.
Sure. And I had a question from Lori McRobbie on my Facebook page, Infectious Disease News, and she asked, Vincent, has the mortality rate changed since the virus was first recorded? I'm talking about H7N9. And has the genome had any variants since it was found? And before you answer that question, Vincent, can you explain real briefly what a genome is?
All right, so the genome is the genetic information of the virus. For influenza virus, it's the nucleic acid inside the particle. For flu, it's in pieces, it's in 8 pieces, and it's composed of RNA as opposed to DNA, which we have. Now, this gives me an opportunity to clarify virulence of a virus. So your listener said mortality rate. The correct term is case fatality ratio, and that is the number of deaths divided by the number of confirmed cases. And right now, that's all we can do for H7N9, because mortality ratio would be the number of deaths over the total number of human infections, whether they have disease or not. And we simply don't know that for H7N9. And as far as we can tell, the case fatality ratio has not changed. It's still around 20 to 30%. So the cumulative number of cases since about a year ago, 188 with 53 deaths. So that's 28%. So no change in the CFR. And, of course, the genome is always undergoing changes in influenza virus. And as isolates are made, they are sequenced. The sequences are deposited into public databases. And, yes, of course, there are changes. Nothing that stands out as being remarkable, nothing in a protein that we think would change the properties of the virus so far.
Fantastic. Okay, well, let's switch gears a little bit, and let me ask you, what's new on Virology Blog? If for those that are not familiar, Vincent runs a website called Virology blog.ws. Did I get that right?
It's just virology.ws.
Virology.ws, fantastic educational tool. So what's new there, Vincent?
Well, as readers may know, we've been translating my lectures into Spanish, and we've just put up some of the more recent lectures in that course. One of the more interesting stories lately has been that India just reached its third anniversary of being free of polio.
Yes, big so, news.
Mm-hmm. Big news, 3 years ago. I have to tell you that, you know, I've been following polio for years. I study it in my lab. And I always thought India would be impossible to eradicate the virus from.
Why is that?
And that is because there are always thousands and thousands of cases in India. The sanitation in many parts of the country is poor, which allows a lot of virus transmission. Immunization efforts were not successful. It seemed like it was necessary to immunize people multiple times to get effective protection. But the WHO, together with the Indian government and health authorities, persevered. They did really good work, and they got rid of it. I am just amazed, especially because in neighboring countries, Pakistan and Afghanistan, the virus is still circulating.
Sure.
And causing polio. So this is a really great accomplishment. To me, this means that we can eradicate polio from the rest of the world because India was the hardest place.
Yeah, it's amazing. I was looking at some of the numbers on that, and it couldn't have been 5 or 6 years ago. India accounted for at least half of all the polio cases in the world.
Right.
So it's really miraculous. What else is going on in Virology Blog?
So we have a couple of posts recently on influenza virus, which if readers are really interested in that, we've talked about that a lot today, they might want to check out it. I wrote a post in the beginning of January about a paper which showed that the neuraminidase, this NA protein that we mentioned earlier, I said that it was important for the virus to move away from the infected cell. Now there's good evidence that the NA is also needed for the virus to cut through mucus when it's infecting you. So now, you know, your respiratory tract is covered with a layer of mucus,
sure,
and it's a protective barrier. And that mucus has a lot of sugar in it, a lot of glycoproteins. And apparently the neuraminidase of influenza virus is really important to cut through that layer and allow the virus to reach your cells and infect it. So something we suspected, but just really never proved.
Yeah, I read that article. It was very, very informative. Also, Vincent, for listeners, Vincent does a weekly video called This Week in Virology, TWIV, and it's really, really some fantastic information. He gets on there with several other virology experts and discuss the issues of the day, and I encourage you to check that out. Check out his website, virology.ws. Well, Vincent, we're running out of time. I just want to let you know, since you're kind of a regular, probably the next time I seek out your knowledge, it'll be at a more reasonable hour. I am going to a one-hour format starting March 1st. I'll be from noon to 1 p.m. on Saturday.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah.
We'll get more listeners.
Yeah, that's the idea. Yeah, nobody's up at this hour. So anyway, I want to thank Dr. Vincent Racaniello, Columbia University microbiology and immunology professor and virology educator extraordinaire. Thank you, Vincent, for joining me again this morning.
Robert, it's been a pleasure. I look forward to talking with you in March.
Yes, sir. Thanks a lot. Have a nice day.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye. All right, I want to thank Vincent again. Always a fantastic guest, always such a wealth of knowledge concerning topics of virology. And let me go ahead and just encourage people to go ahead and check out theglobaldispatch.com. That's the website I own and work with my partner Brandon Jones. And we have a section in there called Outbreak News. I do my best to keep up on what's going on around the world, so check that out, theglobaldispatch.com. Have a great weekend, and I'll see you next Saturday. We'll be talking about porcine epidemic diarrhea. Bye-bye.
Calling this morning at 9 a.m. and this afternoon at noon here on the Tan Talk Radio Network.
WTAN Clearwater, Tampa Bay. WDCF Dade City, Tampa Bay. WZHR Zephyr Hills, Tampa Bay. Listen.
NBC News Radio, I'm Kristen Welker at the White House.